Good morning. Welcome to all of you who are with us here in the sanctuary and those that are joining us on the live stream. You are together with us as we are all together in worship today. Especially if you're a guest with us today, it is fantastic that you are together with us. And so let me also say happy Father's Day to all the fathers. Isn't it a great thing to be a father? Great thing to be a father. I say that I understood the love of God, my father, so much more when our first child was born. Here's the thing about being a good father, that one of the qualities I think of a good father is a father who meets their child where the child is at. Continues to lead and to challenge, but meets them where they're at. We all maybe have fallen into the trap, or we've seen sometimes when dads want that child to be farther along in some way than the child is. We see that, unfortunately, a lot of times on the sports field. But a good father is one that meets the child, son or daughter, where he or she is at. And that child never doubts the unconditional love and acceptance of the father. Well, that points us in the direction we're headed today as we continue our journey with the account of Gideon from the book of Judges. We're calling it the Gideon Summer. And we're going to learn how God the Father, our Father, met Gideon right where Gideon was at and gave to Gideon what he needed at that time in order to take the next step in following the Lord. And in this way, we'll learn, most importantly, that God, our Father, meets us where we're at. It is so good to be together, and I invite us now to enter fully into worship as we sing our first song. Let's stand.
Jesus, let your kingdom come. Children. the greatest miracles in the history of the earth is when Jesus came down to be with us. And today, let's sing of that glorious day when he called you and he called me by name. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. That's okay. Let's get this back on track. As soon as it rolls back. Computers are great. Sometimes they just take longer.
This song is worth hearing twice.
I was buried beneath my shame. Day. me. Patient God, thank you for being patient with that last song. Over and over again, you have given your people signs and wonders and miraculous things to demonstrate your love and your power. When our faith falters, meet us where we are and bolster our faith through signs when we ask. And help us to take you at your word through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated. Well, if you're new to St. Luke, my name is Aaron, and we're so glad that you're here today. We have two scripture readings today. Our first lesson comes from Judges chapter 6, beginning at verse 33. Judges chapter 6, the words will be on the screen. Now all the Midianites, Amalekites, and other eastern peoples joined forces and crossed over the Jordan and camped in the valley of Jezreel. Then the Spirit of the Lord came on Gideon, and he blew a trumpet, summoning the Abizarites to follow him. He sent messengers throughout Manasseh, calling them to arms, and also into Asher, Zebulun, and Naphtali, so that they too went up to meet them. Gideon said to God, "If you will save Israel by my hand, as you have promised, look, I will place a wool fleece on the threshing floor. If there is dew only on the fleece, and all the ground is dry, then I will know that you will save Israel by my hand, as you have said." And that is what happened. Gideon rose early the next day. He squeezed the fleece and wrung out the dew, a bowl full of water. Then Gideon said to God, "Do not be angry with me. Let me make just one more request. Allow me one more test with the fleece, but this time make the fleece dry and let the ground be covered with dew." That night, God did so. Only the fleece was dry, and all the ground was covered with dew. Our gospel lesson today comes from John chapter 20, beginning at verse 24. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands? Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told them, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you too may have life in his name. This is the word of our Lord.
So is it okay to ask the Lord for a sign to bolster your faith when your faith is faltering? Is it okay to do that? What do you think? Have you ever asked God for a sign? I think by and large, Lutheran Christians don't do that very often. We kind of stay away from that stuff. Well, that's what Gideon did. He asked the Lord for a sign, and not just once. He repeatedly asked God for a sign when his faith was faltering. We're in the series Gideon Summer. We're looking at this account of Gideon in the book of Judges. Gideon was a judge. It really was a leader, and in Gideon's case, especially a military leader, 12 centuries before Jesus was born. And he was a leader of the Hebrews at a time when the Hebrews were being severely oppressed by an ethnic group called the Midianites. That is when the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon and said, "The Lord is with you, mighty warrior." And we talked a few weeks ago how that's a little bit ironic, or there's a disconnect here, because when the angel calls him mighty warrior, he's anything but that. Hiding out down in a kind of a hit dugout place in the ground where they pressed out wheat and grapes so that he could hide the food that, from the Midianites. So he's anything but a mighty warrior when the angel says this to him. But the angel of the Lord can see what Gideon cannot see about himself. Well, then God himself appeared to Gideon and said this: "Go in the strength you have and save Israel out of Midian's hand. Am I not sending you?" Now, Gideon had no question about what the Lord meant here. He didn't have to say, "Sir, what do you mean by that?" Gideon knew that that meant that the Lord was calling Gideon to attack militarily this enormous, powerful Midianite army. This is how the book of Judges describes the overwhelming military force of the Midianites. It was impossible to count the men and their camels. They invaded the land to ravage it. And then later on in the count, the camels could no more be counted than the sand on the seashore. I have just found it humorous, all this talk about so many camels as a way of describing the overwhelming force that Gideon was up against. There were so many camels. And I thought we should use that. We should use that as a kind of catchphrase anytime we're up against something that seems overwhelming. Just a kind of way of kind of keeping it a little bit humorous. Like something's oppressing in your life, something difficult's happening, God has called you to do something you think you can't really face, and you just say, "But Lord, there are so many camels." That tickles me. When facing this overwhelming force of so many camels, Gideon's faith faltered. And he was not certain that God's call was going to be fulfilled through him to free the Hebrew people from the Midianites. And so Gideon needed some more convincing. And so he asked God for a sign. And the Lord repeatedly met Gideon right where he's at and gave him the sign to bolster his faith. 2 weeks ago, Pastor Mike used the part of the account where Gideon sets up this offering and the Lord just burns it all up. And it was a sign that Gideon needed. And it bolstered his faith. And so Gideon then, because of that sign, steps out a little bit in faith. He kind of does a warm-up act. We might call it a pre-season adventure, where he takes down, because you see, Gideon's father worshipped other gods. He had set up idols on his property. To Baal and to an Asherah pole. And so Gideon in the nighttime, not in the daylight, but in the nighttime, kind of does a little preseason game here, and he takes down those idols. And he survives. And Pastor Mike taught us how in that way that God brings us, when he burns up the offering, he brings them from weakness to strength. And that when he tears down the idols, that's a bold move. It comes from the inner strength that God gave to Gideon. And he survives, though. Even though people are upset about him doing that, he comes through it. And so God has shown up with signs, meeting Gideon where he's at, over and over again. But now comes the big event, to take on the great Midianite army with so many camels. And Gideon's not certain again. He needs some more convincing. And so he asks God for a sign, a kind of quirky, nature-defying sign. He says, I'm going to put out a fleece of wool on the ground, and in the morning, make the dew fill that fleece of wool, but not the ground around it. And I love how the scriptures say it. And it says, and that's what happened. No questions asked. No chastising of Gideon, like, come on, dude, I've showed up 3 times already, and you still need another sign? God just meets him where he's at and gives him that sign. In fact, it says that Gideon could take the fleece of wool and wring out a bowl full of water. I mean, when God answers a sign, sometimes he does it in abundance. But Gideon still wasn't there, was he? He needed another sign. In fact, just the opposite. He said, and he was polite about it. He said, you know, don't be angry with me, God. But if you could just give me one more sign. This time, make the ground wet with dew and the fleece dry. And it says that's what the Lord did. God met Gideon right where he's at and gave him what he needed in order to continue to step out in faith. That's what God does with us. In fact, maybe you've heard this term, fleece the Lord or fleecing the Lord. Have you ever heard that term? It sounds a little bit disrespectful or sacrilegious, like we're going to fleece the Lord. Usually when we think about fleecing, it's like cheating somebody in something. But what it means here is to ask God for a sign, to put a, they usually say, you know, put a fleece out to the Lord, something that you are concerned about, that you need some assurance, fleece the Lord. So, let me ask again. When your faith is faltering, is it okay to ask the God for a sign, to fleece the Lord? Is it okay? So Thomas did in our gospel lesson today. He said, I'm not going to believe unless I see and touch. And so the next week, the next Sunday, Jesus shows up, Thomas is there, and Jesus, no questions asked, no chastisement, says, here, Thomas, here I am, come and touch my hands, touch my side. Jesus met Thomas where Thomas was at, with the sign that he needed to bolster his faith when it was faltering. This is what God has done so often. In the New Testament, in the accounts of Jesus, there are a number of times when someone says, are you the Messiah? Are you the guy that you say you are? And Jesus will say, look at the signs. Look at the miracles. The blind see, the lame walk. Lepers are cleansed, the dead are raised. Jesus pointed to the signs that he did as a way of bolstering faith. In the book of Acts, we see that as well, where it was the signs that happened that bolstered this young, struggling, fledgling movement of Christ followers. In the very early church, that we see described in the New Testament, signs were understood to be one way, not the only way, but one way that the Lord bolsters faith. The writer of Hebrews in the book of the New Testament wrote this. This salvation, that is the salvation we have in Jesus, which was first announced by the Lord Jesus, was confirmed by those who heard it, that heard him. That's the apostles, Peter, James, John, Martha, and Mary. Then it says this. God also, so this is following when Jesus was here. God also testified to it by signs, wonders, and various miracles, and by gifts of the Holy Spirit as distributed according to his will. So in the New Testament times, they saw those signs, and I think asked for those signs as a way of God giving testimony to the truth of Jesus to bolster their faith. I want you to know, church, this is an important passage to me. It's in my prayer journal, and every Thursday I pray this for our family of faith here. I say, God, testify to your salvation at St. Luke through signs and wonders and various miracles and gifts of the Holy Spirit distributed according to your will. That's what this Lutheran pastor does. And Lutherans don't think this way too often, do they? So is it okay? Is it okay to ask God for signs? To fleece the Lord? I would say yes. God works through signs and miracles and various gifts of the Holy Spirit in order to bolster faith. But I don't think in our stream of faith, our tradition, we think about that very often. Have you ever asked God for a sign? I mean, straight up, like, God, give me a sign. Have you ever asked that? Many times. I would guess that some are like, that's never occurred to me to do. You know, because we might think it's a little bit bold. We might be a little afraid as what might happen. We might think that's a little not very humble, or it's not right to test God. It also could be, frankly, sometimes, let's be honest, a lack of faith. Let me ask you, you yourself, not the person sitting next to you or someone in another, you know, charismatic church. Does it take more faith for you to ask for a sign or not ask for a sign? Does it take more faith for you to ask for a miraculous sign or not? I think for many of us in our tradition, that's a step of faith that we're not used to. It was almost exactly 21 years ago right now when Katie and I were spending a week in prayer to discern whether or not God was calling us to St. Luke Lutheran Church. And so every day we would pray and we'd meet, and then we'd each vote at the end of that time in the evening, and we had to make the decision by Friday. Wednesday night, we had come to the conclusion this was God's call, which was, I have to tell you, shocking to us, quite unexpected. And we were not surprised, we were shocked it had happened. Thursday morning, we wake up, I'm getting ready to go to work. Katie says, I don't know. I'm just not certain. I need more assurance. And I said something I'd never said in my life as a Lutheran. I said, well, ask God for a sign. And I remember thinking to myself, what am I saying? We don't think that way. I said, ask for a sign. She said, okay. Within an hour. God gave us a sign. It was quirky. It had to do with an obscure passage in the Old Testament where there's some lions involved. And if you know, Gehenna's mascot is the lions. And, you know, and it came from the other pastor of the church who was trying to convince me to stay. And, you know, it's a quirky story. But it was clear to us that was a sign. And I remember calling Katie and saying, within an hour of me saying that to her, I said, this is what just happened. She goes, well, okay, there it is. That's a sign. Have you ever asked God for a sign and waited for him to give you that sign? I want to encourage you to do it. Step out in faith. In a moment when your faith might be faltering, in a moment when you need to know what direction to take, in a moment when you're not sure if that nudging you're hearing from the Lord is something that is the Lord's call, say, God, give me a sign so I know. That's what Gideon did. That's what Thomas did. That's what the apostles did. That's what followers of Jesus have done throughout the centuries. It's what your pastor has done. People in your congregation have done. Ask for a sign. God meets us where we're at, like a good father. But I also need to say this. Our trust in Jesus cannot continually rely on signs. Because the relationship we have with the Lord, an eternal relationship, has to be based on faith, not on proof. We can't keep saying to God over and over again, just show me one more time. He'll do that. He'll meet us. But he wants to call us beyond that. Just like Jesus called Thomas beyond that, he said, now stop doubting and believe. Trust in the Lord. One time Jesus encountered a Samaritan woman. This is recorded in John chapter 4. You know what they thought of the Samaritans. They thought they were pagans, that they'd turn their back on the true faith, not to be trusted, very suspect. And so he encounters this Samaritan woman. And as he encounters her in the course of that conversation recorded in John chapter 4, she comes to know that Jesus is the Messiah. And so she goes back to her town and she says, I found him. And then it says this, that because of her testimony, the townspeople hadn't even met Jesus. They said, because of her testimony, many Samaritans believe, which was extraordinary. They didn't even see Jesus just because of her teaching. Well, shortly after that, Jesus goes back to his home area, his hometown, Galilee. And it says in the account that many of the people in Galilee, many of the Jews in Galilee, had seen Jesus do miraculous signs, had all the testimony they needed to know that he was who he said he was. The Son of God, the Messiah. So a royal official comes and says to Jesus, would you come and heal my son? He's sick. Jesus did heal the boy, as he always did. But before he did that, this is how Jesus responded. Unless you people see signs and wonders, Jesus told them, you'll never believe. Now, I don't know how to take that statement. I don't know if it's just a statement of fact, like, yeah, you need to see signs and wonders, and then you believe. Or if it's a bit of a chastisement, like you keep looking for signs. And we see as the Gospel of John unfolds that Jesus starts to point them like you can't, your faith can't rely on always being proved, it being proved to you over and over again. Because God wants us to grow in faith, to make bold moves, to move forward the kingdom of God, as Gideon did, as Pastor Mike talked about in the wonderful sermon last week. God meets us where we're at, and if where he needs to meet us is to give us a sign so that we grow in that, he'll do that, but he wants us to move beyond that, to live by faith alone. So here's the next step for today. Better than asking God for a new sign, take God at his word. Take God at his word. Now, if a step of faith for you would be to ask for a sign, which I think it would be for many here, do that. But take God at his word. Because remember this, dear ones, what Jesus finally said to Thomas. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That's us. That's us. Let's pray. Good and gracious God, our faith falters too often. We're filled with doubts and hesitancies. We know that you call us to make bold moves in advancing your kingdom. And sometimes, like Gideon, we hesitate. And Thomas, we doubt. When that happens, Lord, move us to ask for a sign and meet us where we're at, as you have always done, Father, good Father, so that we will know that it is true, that you are with us, that the salvation we have in Christ is reliable. Meet us where we're at, whatever we need, so that we can continue to grow in faith. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. I invite you to stand. On the night that Jesus was arrested, the night before he was crucified, he instituted what some might call a sign. We understand it's more than just a sign, it's a sacrament. But it is a tangible way that Jesus said, here, I'll give you this to bolster your faith. What we call the sacrament of Holy Communion. In the night in which he's betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Again, after supper, he took a cup that was filled with wine, and when he'd given thanks, he gave it to all to drink, saying, this cup is new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Jesus taught us to pray this prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. I invite you to follow the directions of the ushers as you come forward. If you are comfortable, you can come right. Move to the center aisle, even if you're on the outside, and come forward to receive the bread and then the wine. There's also gluten-free wafers if that's what you desire. And there, if you want to stay in your seat and you picked up one of the prepared cups, you can take that at any time during communion. So I invite us forward in faith to receive this sign, which is more than a sign but a sacrament of the body and blood of Christ.
Walking around these walls, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet. Waiting for change to come, knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence, you never failed. invite you to stand and sing this with me. I know the night won't last. Your word will come to pass. My heart will sing your praise again. Jesus, you're still enough. Keep me within your love. My heart will sing your praise again. Promise still stands. Great is your faith.
move into a time of prayer, and we do this every Sunday. But as we've heard God's word today, when I say, Lord, in your mercy, and we all say together, hear our prayer, let that be a way of saying, God, show us a sign. Answer this prayer. Heal, restore, protect, visit us. Let that be our step of faith today. Holy God, you gather your people from east and west and north and south in your church, and we pray for the mission of your church throughout the world and for our mission here at St. Luke in particular, that your steadfast love will be made known to all peoples who yet do not know Christ, that through our witness, our individual evangelism, in sharing the love of Jesus, more may come to know Jesus and be saved. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, you keep watch over all the nations. We pray for countries experiencing violence and hunger and unrest. We ask that you guide the worldwide and local community organizations in their effort to establish safety and justice. Lord, in your mercy. Your scripture tells us that you are close to the brokenhearted and near to those who are in distress. And so we pray for those who are experiencing oppression of any kind. Liberate them from the systems and chains that bind them, from the illnesses and sicknesses that keep them down. Remove the barriers that separate us from one another. We pray especially for Doug Rose and Don Clampfith and Belinda DeSario and Glenn Maxwell, Carol Ebersole, Brandy Jones, Ken Kwiatkowski, Jerry McHugh, Sandra Roby, Angela Spain. We pray for those who've lost loved ones in recent days, that you'd comfort them with the hope of the resurrection, the family and friends of Dan Johnson and of Dale Grillo. And we celebrate, Lord, with those who have experienced new life in their journey with you, those that have been recently married, Hannah and Justin Young and Morris and Ruth DeMulio. And we celebrate the healthy birth of Reese Caroline Howard to Mark and Lily. All of these dear ones that we pray for, Lord, we pray that you would again be faithful and meet them where they're at in their needs. Lord, in your mercy. You dwell with us in this faith community. And so we pray for the leaders and elders of our church. Grant them knowledge, patience, and kindness that through their leadership you may be exalted in this assembly. Lord, in your mercy. We lift these prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. You may be seated. We again welcome you here in our sanctuary, and those of you that are joining us online, again, we say happy Father's Day to all of you fathers. Pastor Mike is being a good father today on vacation and coaching his son in baseball. So we hope that they win. Speaking of baseball, we have two nights at the Clippers game that is coming up for our congregation to go together and share that experience together. And this Friday, June 25th, and Sunday, August 8th, the cost of the tickets are $8.50. We all sitting together, and Steve Howard has done his work, so we're not looking into the sun. They're great seats. You can purchase those from Steve Howard at the worship after the service or contact him directly. His email and phone are in the bulletin. As we've now begin to phase back in and we continue to do more and more on Sunday morning, we do need help, because during the pandemic, our Sunday helpers crew was depleted. And there are a number of rewarding ways for you to help on Sunday mornings. Ushering, sound system, sermon slides, live stream, altar guild, the coffee team will train you. And it is so helpful. I have to tell you, as one of the leaders up here, to know that that stuff's taken care of really is gives me peace. And when it's not, it gives me stress. So I encourage you to step up and do this. You can sign up on the back of your connection card right now, and I'd ask you to begin filling that out if you haven't done so, and you can put it in the offering plate as you leave today. You can also sign up online through our Church Center app or simply contact the church office. Please give us your help with this. A number of months ago, we announced to you that we had gotten a subscription to something that's called Right Now Media. Who's seen something on Right Now Media? Raise your hand. A good number. Yeah, good. This is a wonderful opportunity. It's free to you because we're paying for the subscription. Anyone who in any way is connected, you don't have to be a member, anyone that's connected, if you're here today, it's free to you to check this out. It's kind of like the Netflix of Bible video studies. It's a free resource. This week, we want to highlight one of the studies we recommend that you can experience on your own or with your family or with your life group. It's called Surprised by Hope by an eminent scholar named N.T. Wright. Watch this video.
Some people, when they look up at those clouds, they have been taught to think, maybe that's what heaven's like. I often get asked, isn't it a bit odd the Christians banging on about the resurrection of Jesus? What's that got to do with real life? It's not up to us to build the kingdom of God. That's what God does. It's up to us to do the particular things that we're called to do, the things that right now give hope to the world. Surely we can have a perfectly good Christian moral standard or even a spirituality without having to say that once upon a time Jesus rose again from the dead. And people often hook that up with other big questions. Just what do we believe about heaven? Just what does the word resurrection itself actually mean? And what is the real Christian hope, both for us and for the world? Those are some of the big issues we'll be looking at, and I think you'll find that when you get a clearer view of what resurrection itself means, it puts everything else in a new light and helps you to make connections, but also much more, to become people of hope in and for the world. That and other things like that is what this course is going to be all about, and I hope you'll really enjoy it.
On about the resurrection. That's a great phrase. I think you'll enjoy that. I know you often ask, what's heaven like? What's resurrection about? That's one way to check it out. So these are things you can look on your own. I know some people are using this almost as a personal time, quiet time with the Lord. I've heard great reports of that, or in with your spouse or your family or your life group. You can get a free account, set up a free account, by clicking on the Right Now Media link on our website, stlukecolumbus.com. I want to encourage you to sign up to get our free email newsletter. If you haven't done that yet, that's how you can stay best connected. Also, check us out on the social media. Like us, share us, so we can continue to spread the news of Jesus. And I invite you to stand and receive his benediction today. Dear ones, live with the sure and certain knowledge that in the death and resurrection of Jesus, all evil has been defeated, and you belong to the eternal kingdom of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let's go out with a bang. There is freedom. There is Father's Day.